morning. Good to have you with us in the 8 p.m. edition of the Urban Debate. This day and this night, in 2016, India was coming to terms with a big announcement of demonetization. The announcement made on 8th, India beginning to discover the impact of it 9th and onwards. Tonight, we're going to talk about the overall impact in life after demonetization 5 years on. At that point, many speculated, many argued, people vociferously backed this move, others equally vociferously opposed this move, and heated discussions went on for weeks together. As people struggled to get rid of their demonetized currency, struggled to get some cash or move on to digital platforms to go about their day-to-day businesses. As companies at that point struggled to keep their businesses afloat, to keep the cash flow going. 5 years on, tonight let's talk about what all of that did. What were the key targets? What were the key objectives of this mega demonetization, the unprecedented move that was taken on by the current government? First up was obviously to tackle black money, as they said. Second one was to weed out the fake currency notes from the system. Crack down on black money, weed out fake currency notes, thereby choking all kinds of dirty funding, including that for terrorists. And of course, there was a bid to formalize the economy, to move more people into the formal sector, to move more people into the digital side. And subsequently, a lot more reasons were given to us. The first main key one was to say this will help crack down on black money, on kala dhan. And everybody who has unaccounted cash will not be able to do anything with it because all of those currency notes had been rendered useless. They were nothing more than paper money. But let's look at it in an overarching manner. What really happened? First up, when it comes to the status of black money, there isn't any exhaustive data that tells us if we've been able to suck out the black money from the system. There isn't any exhaustive data that tells us how many of these people who had black money of them have actually been identified, penalized, and so on and so forth. Some of those cases are going on. But almost all of the demonetized currency actually ended up returning to the Reserve Bank of India. Over 99% came back to the Reserve Bank of India, raising questions on where was the black money and how did all the cash then come back. And people had found loopholes into the system to put the money back into the system any which ways. The other big one was about cash in circulation. If you look at today, the cash in circulation is 64% more than what it was just before demonetization was announced. Now, while it has grown along with the nominal GDP, if you compare it to the real GDP, the percentage of cash is actually higher simply because we have witnessed a significant drop in our GDP itself. Fake currency notes. 2020, we saw an increase in fake currency seizures by 190%. So while, yes, in the immediate few months after the demonetization was announced, the circulation did go down because obviously all of those notes were not of any use. It's pretty much back right up there, showing significant growth year after year. What has helped though is income tax returns. They have surged by over 70% since 2016. Digital transactions, they have seen a massive surge from 0.29 million at that point of time to 4.2 billion transactions that are happening now. But many argue this would have happened either which ways. India was already moving in this direction. Maybe it did get an extra push. What was the cost of demonetization? The economic activity in the subsequent quarter itself, 3 months itself, went significantly down at 2 percentage points is what the government and the advisors themselves admitted. The informal segment suffered massively. A lot of it has not returned back. And subsequent problems in the economy and the pandemic just made it worse. But remember, the economy did start slowing down even before the COVID hit us. The pandemic made it worse, but the economy was already in a downward trajectory. Unemployment hit a five-decade high in 2017-2018. So while there were some hits, there were many, many misses. And so for all of those conversations and debates that we had at that point of time, we thought it would be good to look back today, after a significant amount of time has passed, to say what did we achieve and at what cost. I say good evening to Karuna Gopal, BJP leader, national in charge for policy and research, joining me this evening. Dr. Anshul Avjit, national spokesperson for the Congress Party. Professor Arun Kumar, chair professor for Institute of Social Sciences, joining me this evening from JNU University. Professor Aman Agarwal, director for IIF. Dr. Ajay Dua, former Commerce Secretary, and Madhavan Narayanan, senior journalist, also with me this evening. Let me start off with Dr. Ajay Dua on his views. If I had to ask you to summarize, what do you think, Mr. Dua, worked for us as far as DEMO is concerned, and where did we massively fail?
Thank you for having me on your show, Tanvi. You've summed up actually all that happened and what's the current position very succinctly already. I would probably be repeating some of those, but let me putting it in a little bit of a context. I think at that point of time, certainly when the demonetization was undertaken on the night of the 8th or the late evening of the 8th of November 2017, the incidence of black money in the country was rather high. We had just come out 2 years ago or 3 years ago out of massive episodes, so-called episodes of corruption, whether it was in telephone allotment of 2Gs or coal, etc. The government took a chance, I would put it this way, saying one way of checking it could be by resorting to rarely done thing, but we'd done it twice earlier, once way back even before independence in 1946 in the country that had been tried, that let's tender the high value notes, 500 and the 1,000 rupee notes, with immediate effect, make them illegal. These constituted 88.3% of our total money in circulation or cash in circulation at that point of time. The goal, with the goals being very clearly eliminating black money and corruption, as well as terrorism funding, the counterfeiting of notes, and those were probably, and bringing greater tax flows so that the poor could be kind of greater money transfer could take place to them, greater support from the government. With these four or five benefits, the deemed benefits of it, digitization came about a little later, or probably a afterthought. I would say what has been achieved and notable achievement, one, the currency, counterfeiting of currency, that has come down. Second, digitization of the economy has gone up sizably with UPI payments just in the month of October itself totaling $100 billion. From a time when it won't happen in the entire economy, we have noticed that on the UPI system itself, we've got $100 billion worth of transactions taking place. Number of other things, not directly demonetization would have helped it, including GST introduction, because people, in order to claim their benefit of output on GST on output, had to show the GST on inputs. So the smaller people also started paying, and all those kind of chain reactions there. The MGNREGA, demand for work on MGNREGA increased. So people are being paid more money directly by the government in their bank accounts. Bank accounts grew, mobile telephone grew. All those things, concomitant factors, have helped. But the question which still goes a begging is, were the three main purposes served? The economic data which has been put out is not supporting that in any significant manner.
Okay.
But the cash flow, the cash in the economy is back even at a higher, you know, with more cash in the economy, even if you take it as a percentage of the GDP, it remains significantly higher than what it was at that point of time.
Right.
Then the GDP, cash or tax GDP ratio, that has not improved either. Third, as you very yourself mentioned, that immediate aim or objective of taking the black money out of the economy probably didn't work out either, because 99.3% of the money, as per the RBI's report itself for that year, had come back, if I remember the figures, 15.2 lakhs out of the 15.4 lakhs, which had actually been was estimated to be there. So having said that, I would say it was on the whole a mixed bag, with some of the minor objectives which have a potential of certainly growing into much bigger benefits, growing are likely, they're getting positively affected, but the immediate goals which were there, particularly
right. So, Dr. Zubair, then, you know, what you said, highlighting some of the changes that came in where there was benefit and other places where there wasn't significant benefit. It begs me to ask the question, but at what cost? That's what I want to know, Professor Arun Kumar. But at what cost did these changes come? The fact that we're looking at higher tax returns, the fact that we're looking at higher digital transactions, some amount of more formalized economy in many parts, does it justify the impact it had on the economy overall?
So, Tanvi, let me step back a little. You see, this demonetization was done on the premise that black means cash. And therefore, if we squeeze out cash, the black economy would go away. But this premise is incorrect. Unfortunately, the policymakers and the common man believe that black means cash. You know, there are two aspects of the black economy. First is the black income generation, and the other is the black wealth that is held. Now, black cash is only 1% of the total black wealth. So if you could squeeze out that cash part, then you would have affected only 1% of the black wealth and not more than that. And as Mr. Dua has mentioned, RBI has itself said that 99.3% of the high denomination currency notes had come back. And we also know where that 0.7% was. It was lying in Nepal, Bangladesh, and various other places. So actually 100% came back, including fake currency. So therefore, you know, you could not squeeze out the black cash part, and therefore the black wealth did not get affected. Black income generation is a process. So, for instance, I under-invoice and over-invoice in my business to generate black income. So if I'm a doctor and I see 50 patients and I declare the income of 30, then the 20 that I don't declare become my black income. This is called under-invoicing. So under-invoicing and over-invoicing does not stop because of demonetization, and therefore black income generation continued. So the two aspects of the black economy, that is black income generation and black wealth, were not affected by demonetization. And that should not have been expected. You know, I've been writing on it since 1985, and I have written in my book also, et cetera, pointing out why it would not work. Now, the question is, what is its economic impact? And I've been saying that, you know, what is the money for in the economy? Money is for transactions, you know. You use it not to eat money, but you use it for transactions. Now, when the transactions stop because of shortage of cash, then immediately the economy gets hurt very badly, especially the unorganized sector, which works in cash. It doesn't use banking, et cetera, et cetera. And therefore, the unorganized sector got hit very, very hard. And you could see that small businesses and micro businesses, they all got hit very hard. So my estimate in my book on the demonetization black economy is that we lost about 10 lakh crore worth of output in the economy. Now, that is a huge loss, and especially for the unorganized sector. And since that time, the unorganized sector has been hit again by GST, and then by the NBFC crisis, and now by the pandemic. So the unorganized sector is constantly getting hit very, very hard. And therefore, you know, it's not able to recover. And that's why, as you pointed out, even before the pandemic, the demand had been falling short, and therefore the rate of growth of the economy had actually come down from 8% to 3.1% in the quarter just before the pandemic. So in other words, the economy has suffered a lot as a result of this without the black economy getting affected. Now, regarding the second goal of terrorism, terrorism continues because it can be financed not only through counterfeit currency, but also through smuggling of gold, smuggling of narcotic drugs, use of hawala, use of dollars, etc. So therefore, in other words, terrorism has, financing has not been affected by the demonetization. Thirdly, regarding the fake currency or counterfeit currency, there was only 400 crores, according to government's estimate, of the fake currency or the counterfeit currency at that point of time. Now, out of 15.44 lakh crore, 400 crores is negligible. And therefore, you know, you cannot do demonetization to get 400 crores out of the system. Secondly, the fake currency is printed by state actors in our neighborhood, and that will not stop. And that's why the 2,000 rupee fake currency note started appearing within a week of the new 2,000 rupee notes coming into the circulation. So in other words, the three goals that the prime minister had set out were not achieved at all, but the cost was very high.
Yes.
Now the question is, did digitization work? Did, you know, the less cash economy work? Now we were already moving in that direction. And let me point out that in the world, there's a technical change that is taking place because of which digitization is taking place. People are using their mobile phones, etc. So therefore, that was a natural direction in which the economy was already moving.
Yeah.
We did not need a demonetization to actually accelerate that. You know, that acceleration has happened now because of the fact that, you know, now we're in a pandemic, people don't want to go out, and that has accelerated. Now, even for digitization, etc., what we need is financial planning and financial literacy. Large number of poor people still are not very comfortable about it. The unorganized sector is not very comfortable. And secondly, we need regulation of the financialization process. And that regulation was not done. So in other words, demonetization was not planned to actually bring in the greater digitization, etc.
Yes.
It suddenly, you know, there was a goalpost change that was done.
Yes, absolutely right. Many of those were actually afterthoughts as you know, it became visible that a lot more people will perhaps resort to digital transactions. It sounded as if, okay, this is a good one that we can present and say, look, this is how the benefits are coming through. Even if there, if you see, the big jump actually in UPI transactions has only taken place in the last couple of years. And like you said, I would agree that a lot of it has to do with the pandemic and many people not even wanting to withdraw the cash or use currency notes or exchange currency notes during the COVID times and then having to resort to digital transactions. Either which ways we were heading for it, was it justified with the cost that had came? Karuna Gopal. Then for the BJP, what is the big benefit that you will tell the people today? What, how did it help us to do demonetization?
Tanvi, I'd like to tell you, the other panelists and the entire country that any transformative policy, any transformative reform does come with a dip in, let's say, in say learning or in the economy itself. And I'm quite surprised that people are passing judgments on transformative policy, which today is still is work in progress. You cannot be conclusive in your judgment when the work is still happening. Now, you yourself would notice that there has been enormous amount of surge in the IT returns that were filed. Earlier, the rich people who were not even a part of the formal economy, they were minting money, they were a part of the informal economy, today have no option but to get into the tax net. Now, as far as the poor is concerned, they are extremely empowered, and I dare anyone to question that today. People have their bank accounts and they today challenge me to pay them through GPay, even if I defer payment saying I don't have any cash on me. So they are completely empowered. And the result, of course, we know is that Modi has been categorically declared as one of the greatest leaders, primarily because of perhaps all these things that are happening. Now, another important thing that I want everyone to notice is that none of these things has come without a holistic plan. There is a cost. Of course, there is a cost. So as I said, any reform, there is a dip. Even if you want to learn a new language, there will be a bit of dip in your own, the language that you speak. And then there'll be a growth trajectory. Any economist would know, any professor would know, any bureaucrat would know this. So you cannot be conclusive. The second thing that I'd like to say that is today, We are saying that demonetization has been a failure, but it has not been planned properly. But I'd like to counter that. Everything has been planned.
No,
totally.
So Karuna, you know what? Demonetization. I'm sorry. Demonetization hasn't been planned properly. Was a debate we had literally 5 years ago. in the month of November. It's not an argument anybody is giving anymore. You are insisting on saying, Karuna Gopal, that we need to give it time. It's been 5 years. I'm not having this conversation about a mega reform that you undertook a month ago or even a year ago. It's been 5 years. That's as much time as a government gets in this country before people judge them on their performance and decide whether they should be there or not. If you're saying we have to wait for longer, how much longer? Are we just going to wait till the time you see the economy performing greatly and say, see, we told you? This is all because of what happened 15 years ago. Is that what the plan is? Please tell us about this holistic plan.
Tanvi, here, let me give you an analogy. It's very important to understand this. The corruption and black money issue is something very, you can compare it to some cancerous growth. It's like a tumor in your body. Mm-hmm. So when that is going to be removed, obviously it comes with a cost. There will be an incision, there will be a
but
loss of
blood. But the tumor is still
there,
in the body is the point everybody is making.
They will be asked, please try to see today, economy is being understood through human physiology and anatomy. In fact, everything in the world is being understood through human physiology.
I get the analogy you're giving me. I'm answering back with the same analogy to telling you that the tumor still exists, Karuna Gopal. It never went away. Two points. One that Professor Kumar also made. All the cash that was in circulation has come back.
One minute.
No, this argument is false. To remove the tumor, there is a cost. You did not manage to remove the tumor, Karuna Gopal.
A latest survey done
by local circles tells you that 70% of the people who bought a property since demo ended up also paying a part of it in cash. The biggest black money exists in real estate and property dealings. 70% of those people still ended up paying a part of their transactions in cash. If that is not black money, then what is?
So look, when I said it, nothing is done in isolation, I told you, you have to also understand. Today, you go to a jewelry store. How is the black money stashed? It is in cash, it is in Benami holdings, and also in gold. Now, go to a jewelry store today. Can you do cash transaction? Please, Tanvi, you're a woman. I want to know that. Now, number two, can you do anything? Please.
I can tell you, as per this survey itself, over 12% of people use cash to buy valuables like property, vehicles, jewelry this festival season.
Hasn't it come down?
Then we should just say this, Anshul Avajit, that the biggest agenda of demonetization that was not told to the people of the country at that time, point of time, who stood for hours in queue, whose businesses went down, who were never able to recover from that kind of a hit, the biggest agenda for the government was to make everybody shift to digital transactions and nothing else. It had nothing else to do with dirty cash or corruption or black money at all, because all of that still exists in the system, Anshul.
Tanvi, first of all, thank you for having this show. We should never, ever, in the history of this country, forget that day. I mean, it was the most disastrous intervention, economic intervention in our history, unprecedented. In fact, the biggest testimony for that is, I would like to remind the BJP counterpart here that the BJP never mentions this in their Salana Jalsas. They never mention this among their list of accomplishments. They've completely forgotten about it. GST, they still mention a bit grudgingly, though, and they've got a whole lot of other things, heightening social tensions, but they never mention Notbandi anymore because they realize how disastrous it was. These kind of ostensible reasons why GST was floated don't exist. They were never those reasons. It was an entirely political project to emasculate the opposition before a very important election, which was the UP election. And in that process, the Prime Minister wanted to be made out to be some sort of a crusading warrior against corruption, this kind of corrupt-free prophet of the age, which is trying to fix a broken system, a blackened system. He thinks that India was born in 2014. It never existed before. It was the dark ages before. So this was his move to do that. Every single move, this is not in isolation, Tanvi. This has only worsened that picture. Every single move that this government made, beginning from Make in India, Startup India, I never get tired of saying this, They were absolutely atrocious for this economy. I need not repeat what you have all said and all the panelists have said. In fact, you've all critiqued this process so well. What I'm going to say is, of course, the money came back. You know, this number we should never forget. 15.44 lakh crores. We all remember it so well now. It all came back. 99.3% came back. Almost 100% came back. And our cash to GDP ratio still remains the same. The other point I want to mention is that immediately afterwards, there were two important decisions, as if this was not enough, to devastate our economy totally. It was like an atom bomb that was thrown, destroying everything in its wake, you know, the aftershocks of which we can still feel. But the other two was equally bad. First one was GST, you know, which was ostensibly, you know, to remove the cascading effects of taxation, you know, tax on tax, etc. You know, have a fully automated indirect tax ecosystem and all that. I remember very well, and I remember its purposes very well. But what it did was, and what DEMO also did was, it increased the gap between the formal and the informal sector. So with GST, what happened was all the micro businesses, all the MSMEs, they all got completely edged out. Mm. They were rendered non-competitive. This is what the DEMO also did. It hit the poor the hardest. And you can still feel the effects of that. After that, the government, you know, actually what it did was it gave concessions to the rich people, which was corporation tax. It reduced that. We don't know what happened. It was done so much as to invest in industry, but we know that industry cannot be, will have no effect unless you improve demand. So there was nothing ever done to improve demand and help the poorest of the poor in this country. Now, Professor Kumar mentioned the informal sector, the unorganized sector, which is highly critical in this argument because it forms 93% of our workforce. They were the hardest hit. We heard about them, you know, as those invisibilized group of people that came to the fore during the pandemic, in the lockdown, when the migrants came out with a coffin on their heads, walking their way to home. We have to wonder what happened to them. Where are they employed now? How have they been affected by DEMO even now?
Okay.
What are the effects of DEMO on them? So
okay.
All these things.
Yeah.
Sorry?
Yes, yes.
No. What I'm saying was the effect on the informal sector has been absolutely devastating by subsequent government policies as well. Even response to the pandemic, where you think that the Atmanirbhar campaign, you know, ever since they said was actually a loan campaign, nothing in terms of fiscal stimulus to the poor and those affected by DEMO, just a, you know, big loan mela. And secondly, it also meant the privatization of our assets. It meant two things, essentially. So none of them have helped. None of them have mitigated the helps of DEMO. And in fact, after that, you can see its aftershocks spread even further and worse.
Okay, I get the point you're making, Anshul. Let me now pick this up and twist it a little. Karuna, I'll come back to you in just a bit. I just have to get Mr. Madhavan to also make his comments. Mr. Madhavan, let's see it from another side. Let's say that the government very well knew what its objectives were, which were to push the economy into a more formalized direction, to push the digital transactions such that it becomes easier to track the transactions and, you know, essentially have a lot more of transparent transactions than anything else. Everything else that was said was simply said to sell the story to us. Because if you just say, oh, we all want you to use UPI and not 500 rupee notes, nobody's going to buy that story. So you sell the story as crackdown on black money, crackdown on fake currency, and everything else. But your motive is this, and that's what you've achieved.
No, I think, Tanvi, you should be writing a web series for Netflix, perhaps, with that kind of an idea. I'm quite clear. I've been writing, let me put it this way. I was writing a series of articles on demonetization from the day it happened. And let me say in all balance that I was skeptical but not negative about demonetization when it started. But what I have seen since then is the constant shifting of the goalposts, which is not acceptable. The idea was very clearly, now, if the government cannot be judged on what it did not say but had secretly in mind, but that can only be in a Netflix series, sorry. So if its purpose, stated purpose, was to curb black money, then Dr. Ashok, Arun Kumar has explained well, there's a lot of black wealth that wasn't tackled, black income. And although I must say sorry to Anshul, Avijit, because Congress has not been winning elections, and BJP has been winning elections in UP as well as re-election of the general government. So some of the social impact of demonetization might have been overestimated by the opposition. But having said that, let me say very clearly that the shifting of the goalposts has been nothing but a PR exercise. So it is like Virat Kohli saying, I lost the T20 World Cup, but because I was rehearsing for a test match. You know, to say that this is a transformative mood, saying that we were practicing for in the T20 World Cup for a test series that is coming, that is the saying, you know, it's transformative, it's a cause, and it's a long-term impact. No, that wasn't it was supposed to be. You're supposed to be judged in 5 years. I also want to mention that the finance minister of that time, Arun Jaitley, is no longer with us, but he had spoken about shell companies on which the government hasn't come out with any data. Nothing seems to have happened, although the number of ITRs may have gone up. And as you yourself pointed out, Tanvi, that the pandemic might have done more for UPI than demonetization has. And therefore, I think those of us who live humbly through facts and logic cannot buy the Picasso painting logic of too many abstractions being thrown in to justify demonetization as a success. It is better for the government to admit that we tried, it was a gamble that failed. But it had a Bollywoodization of the war on black money, where you had lots of people standing in queues and people feeling that something was being done visibly by the government to crack on. So it had a nice atmospherics, and that might have rubbed off even positively on Mr. Modi's political image, because politics doesn't follow the simple rules of urban drawing room logic of facts and logic. Because politics is about imagery, and Mr. Modi might have scored on the demonetization imagery the way he scored on the Balakot imagery, because politics works on different tracks. But I would not buy the argument that digitalization of the economy was the hidden motive behind demonetization. It was very clearly an attempt to politically justify the manifesto promise of the fact that they will do something about black money,
okay,
but without taking into account the details of the fact that black wealth, as excellently explained by Dr. Arun Kumar, as well as the investments in real estate, had already come back to India. It wasn't in Swiss bank. And by the way, in our family, we still have 500 rupee notes lying somewhere in the corner of a almirah, which was discovered later. So there's more money than what the Reserve Bank has got. So there's a lot of concern. And my big smoking gun in this is the shell companies, because they were supposed to be cracking down on shell companies. Nothing has happened. ITR returns might have been part of the secular growth of the middle class of the economy, thanks to every sector. And GST might have had a good impact on some of the regularization of the economy. And I do agree with Karuna Gopal on some of the aspects, but that would be only 10 to 20% of the logic. The big elephant in the room was black money.
Yeah.
And it's also a fact that the Indian small and informal sector runs on cash, and it has been punched in the solar plexus by the demonetization. And all credit to the Indian people who like to give the Prime Minister a chance to try efforts and magnanimously re-elect him, because this was not the only criteria on which they voted, I'm sure of that. They had everything from national security to personalities to the fact that they want to give somebody a chance.
Yes, a lot of it, in fact, Mr. Madhavan, like you rightly pointed out about subsequent elections that were won, were also perhaps not so much as to what it finally did, but for the fact that someone tried to do something about it. Whether it helped or didn't is a completely different matter, and I don't think anybody now wants to go back and see how much their life benefited or didn't, and if that becomes a reason for them to make the electoral choice. But the messaging was very clear that this government was trying to tackle black money, trying to tackle corruption, and by that much was perhaps enough for many of the voters. But the point that you raise is very important about shell companies, because I was going to ask just this question to Professor Aman Agarwal. Are there other ways to judge whether we were able to crack down on black money? All right, all the cash which was there, perhaps we thought there was lesser cash than there was in reality outside, all of it came back. Are there other things that we can look at, shell companies, or any other statistic or measurement that the government has given us on how much of black money have they cracked down on? Even people who put their cash back into the system and then the income tax department evaluated it and found that this was dirty money. I don't have that data. Professor Agarwal, anything on that?
You see, Tanvi, I would like to put my points on the earlier issue also, but before that, since you raised this question on black money, there are a large number of methods and things which can be done and which have been in the pipeline but not been implemented for almost 30 years. Money Laundering Act got created from FERA to FEMA and then to Money Laundering Act based on our study, which got published in Finance India. And then further, the Parliament of India consulted us and created the Money Laundering Act. But that still did not control it. The KYC norms were introduced based on a work again, but it could not also get into the way. Why? Because accountability is something which is still a question. You see, recently, with one of the banks, large banks in this country, one of the former chairmen has been questioned, and he is being put with charges. What are the other former chairmen coming up and saying? That, oh, if you're going to do this, then what will happen? No lending will take place. No chairman will take its action, and they will not do their jobs. Now, if that is the way we are going to talk about accountability, whether it is in the political arena or the government framework, then I don't think we are looking at any kind of a non-creation of black money or corruption not being there. You see, the administrative reforms which were suggested way back in 97, 98, or the whole report, the whole bill has been pending and has not been introduced even till today for the fact that the government machinery is itself not interested in some of these accountability formats. And if that doesn't happen, let me tell you, we don't think anywhere the black money or the corruption will go away. Mm-hmm. Now, the two issues which you raised up, which is the title of your talk today, is a 5-year of demonetization. We are not talking of the fact that it is to be introduced. Why are we discussing it in the form that we are supposed to be introducing it tomorrow? We are not introducing it tomorrow. We are not looking at the objectives tomorrow. There are a few things which have come out as an outfall or as a pitfall of demonetization, which in my opinion are critical and key factors. One is a psychological impact which has had on the people of this country, which has actually been there, that you do not generate and try to create this kind of money. Secondly, the M3, which is called the money supply, which is there, has been ranging between every year. The creation of M3 is roughly about 9 to 10% now for almost last 4 years or so. Whereas it used to be between 15 to 18%. That means new creation of money which is being pumped into the economy. You see, it's not withdrawal from banks, which has happened now, which is holding of more cash as against holding it in the bank accounts. That is a secondary issue. But the creation of new money has reduced substantially, which used to be very high. Thirdly, you see, you can certainly, what Arun talked about, the growth factor, certainly I agree with it. There was a major hump, and that was beyond control. It would have happened at any stage or any such kind of act happens, whether it is GST or it is any other. Now, the governments are opposing the petrol to be introduced in GST. They're going to have a big bump. That's what they're worried about as well. And that is something which is going to always happen when this kind of a thing happens. But please understand, when we saw a GDP of high figure, we also saw inflation, which used to be in double digits. All through the early 2010s, we saw high inflation figure. So that means the real effect of GDP was being eaten away and the people will not benefit from that GDP growth which is taking place. That has been under control. We have had inflation fairly strongly under control for a long time. And you can see the consistency in the RBI monetary policy and the way the rates have been coming forth and keeping the economy growing.
No, so, Professor Agarwal, coming back...
Give me 2 minutes more. Yeah. Please give me 2 minutes more, Tanvi. Fourth point, we are seeing a foreign exchange reserve of over $642 billion, almost $100 billion in the last 1 year itself. At the time when there was corona, when economies are struggling to survive, when fiscal spending is taking place, industries and institutions not investing, we saw an inflow of foreign direct investment in this country. The highest, about $6.5 billion every month last year trend itself. Portfolio investment also jumped up. Now, please tell me, if the international market, which would have jolted whenever a demonetization takes place, whether it was Singapore or India or any other country in the past, they have given a negative signal to the market. Despite that negative signal, this government has been able to motivate international agencies, international institutions, investors to come and invest in this country and make it a home for themselves, for both this country and otherwise.
But Professor Agarwal, you say an unprecedented... Okay, last point.
Last point. The amount of GDP growth we are seeing in this country is the highest in the world. We are still among the top three nations on the PPP basis in GDP growth. That is about $12 trillion. Whereas among the top 7 to 8 countries in the GDP growth worldwide.
None of the what you're listing out here, none of what you're listing out here is related to demonetization. None of what you're listing out here. Allow me now. The last 3 points that you made. You made a point about fuel prices and inflation, what it was in the previous regime and now. You made a point about foreign direct or indirect investments, as well as extremely high forex reserves that, frankly, the government right now is a bit concerned about how to tackle it and what to do with it. And then you made a point about the economic growth. None of this is actually a fallout or related to demonetization. In fact, if I had to buy your arguments about how things are much, much better right now than they were in the previous government's regime, I would say things would have been perhaps even better if it wasn't for demonetization. We would have been at an even better place when the pandemic hit us. We would have gotten out of the GST impact and the pandemic impact faster than we did because of demonetization. So if I am to buy your arguments, my counter would be that it would actually be, we would be in a much, much better place than even now if it wasn't for demonetization. How has demo helped in any of these?
Yes. Firstly, when there was a change in this framework, not forget the digitalization framework, which has come much later also and has impacted. You see, there is a shift from an informal to a formal. When there is a shift, there is less creation of a black economic framework. The psychological movement, you see, in India, we got independence, a patriotic India which got independence. 98% tax by this country. Imagine 10 rupees you earn, 9 rupees you give to the government of India. That was a rule which was set up in 1947. We were $2 for 1 rupee, stronger than a currency. We had fallen tremendously. We have been consistently weakening ourselves. What has happened? The purchasing power was going down. Inflation was very high in 2013 and 14. Fortunately, in 15, the inflation was fairly troubling us. The cost of what we could buy was not there. People were not even planning. Those who had money were throwing away money. Those who did not have money were not. There has been a readjustment there again. And there is an equity which is distributing. I don't see that complete devastation which used to take place between 2010 to 2016 had already taken place. Again, I am not here mooting for demonetization or that it should be done again. What I am trying to say is we are looking at 5 years of demonetization. How has it impacted the economy? How is the world looking at it? How are people in this country, the masses, looking at it? Lastly, the credit cards came in 1970s. They talked about all annual reports in the 70s and 80s said, we will make it cashless. No economy has made it. None of the economies around the world have made it cashless. But this particular act has made the largest population of this country, the masses, the base, which is the real economy of the country, real strength of a country, to move to a framework which could never have happened with whatever level of literacy you could introduce in this world, despite government aid, despite financial institutions. Even SEBI has not been able to teach institutions to trade. Even RBI has not been able to teach people how to go about managing their accounts. Forget so many. Yeah, 70,
you needed a mobile revolution that of the kinds that only companies have managed to do now. I'm sorry, I wouldn't say that you can give the complete credit to this one exercise called demonetization with the cost that it came. There are many, many other factors involved, including the pandemic, including the way mobiles are now being used in the smallest of the places, and people discovering how easy that access is. But two other panelists want to make comments now. I'm going to go across to Ajay Dua first and then to Karuna. Yes, Mr. Dua.
Tanvi, I would look at this measure, as some of the panelists have taken the position, in a slightly longer term framework and not in the immediate. There was certainly disruption, there was certainly dislocation of the kind which we have all talked about now, as well as 5 years ago. I remember doing a show with you exactly on this subject 5 years ago as well. But I think the long-term measurement has to be in terms of what has it done to the growth of the economy and what has it done for unemployment or employment creation in the country. I don't see the picture having improved in the last few years in respect of either. Whatever may have been said by my panelists, I would like to draw attention to the fact that certainly economy was growing in 2015-16. We've seen good growth, but subsequent to it, starting with demonetization, there has been an incessant fall, which got accentuated with the first year of the pandemic. This year's the rate of growth, which he's talking about amongst the three best in the world, etc. In our case, is a slightly different matter because it's from a low base. A base where first the GDP fell by 20% during the pandemic, last year recovered by 7.7%. So it is still lower than what it was in the pre-pandemic. And we are measuring our growth of the current year, 9.5 or 9, whatever we see, on that low base. What excites me, however, is the projection of everybody, including the IMF, that next year, when this base effect would be over, we would be seeing 8.5%. And I give, you know, all strength to the arms of the government and the policymakers that let's hope that materializes. That will be creditable. Second is this call, and that is a thing which is worrisome. Mm-hmm. We have neither before the demonetization nor after been able to handle the issue of employment in the country. If anything, the pandemic hit the people, the salaried people, the contractual labor, etc., much more than the people who were in the upper echelons of the economy. And consequently, we've seen that if anything, who benefited during the economy? The super rich.
Right.
The number of billionaires of the country has gone up, crossed the figure 100, and probably the maximum number of billionaires which emerged was in India during the pandemic.
Right.
So my concern finally is that let us measure in this country every economic measure against whatever requirement is. And these two factors, to my mind, should invariably be both the short term, saying in the short term they are not affected, and in the long term, there is a beneficial effect on these two measures.
Well, you know, we would have another conversation soon where you and Aman Agarwal should definitely be there, where we talk about how you see the state of the poor, the state of the rich, the state of employment and the economic growth. Mr. Madhavan, to you, and then Professor Kumar, I see your hand. I'll come to you as well.
Very quickly, I would like to disagree with Mr. Dua on the fact that the demonetization was not about jobs and employment. It was about black money. I would look for two bits of statistics which I cannot see. One is not the rise in the number of income tax returns, but the share of direct taxes in the tax to GDP ratio is the number that I would look for. Because GST collections do not convey black money. If the share of direct taxes as a proportion of GDP has grown up during the past 5 years significantly, I would call it as some kind of a salutary positive impact of the demonetization. The other might be any study by an institution such as the National Institute of Public Finance and Policy, which has in the past conducted studies on the extent of black economy, to say that black income generation has been disincentivized as a social impact of what was done by Mr. Modi in 2016. I do not see any such data. The third data could be anything on shell companies, on which there has been a horrible silence from the government. So if we have to talk numbers, let us talk numbers that are relevant, please. Thanks.
Okay. You know, you're extremely right. In fact, I will add one more to that, because I very clearly remember the finance minister at that point of time, the then finance minister, also talking about how even if the money has come back, they're going to now sit and analyze all of those accounts, whether the people who are putting this money back are putting clean money or dirty money, and penalize and prosecute those people. The government never really came back with exhaustive figures on how many of those people were actually punished and black money identified. Professor Kumar, to you. You wanted to make a point.
Yeah. So there are many facts that, you know, need to be put into the, you know, discussion. For instance, it was argued that the income tax department would, you know, prosecute everybody, or at least try to find out those who had deposited more than 5 lakhs of rupees in their bank accounts. But, you know, what the data suggests is that only 1,000 cases were launched and only 28 prosecutions took place, you know. whereas actually, you know, lakhs and lakhs of people had deposited more than 5 lakhs, as Arun Jaitley had presented the figure in the parliament. So in other words, you know, this idea that we will be able to catch those people who have been depositing money in their bank accounts, that didn't work. Secondly, Jandhan accounts were misused. So suddenly from, you know, some like 20,000 crore, the Jandhan accounts shot up to more than 75 lakh crores. And out of that, 30 lakh crores was withdrawn, and still there were 75 lakh crores. So in other words, you know, the poor people are used as cash mules by the well-off sections to try and, you know, whiten their, you know, black money that they had earlier. Now, there also we failed. Then the 2.38 lakh shell companies were closed down, according to Mr. Arun Jaitley, when he gave the figures in 2018. Now, that also does not have any impact because the number of shell companies has again risen back to where they were earlier. So in other words, the shell companies are constantly used to do under-invoicing, over-invoicing, and hawala. And that process is continuing. That has not helped. Then, you know, it was said that, you know, some like 5-6 crore additional people are filing returns. But as the Prime Minister said on 15th August, effective number of taxpayers remains 1.5 crores. And that number has not risen. And that's why the tax GDP ratio, which had gone up to 6%, has come down to 5.5%. Mm-hmm. Part of that, you know, of course, could be because of the pandemic. But we know that in the pandemic itself, because the rich people have made a lot of money, therefore, 74% increase has taken place in the direct tax collection. And yet it is only 5.5% of the GDP. So if the black economy had been tackled effectively, then this figure should have risen to at least 8 or 9 or 10% rather than remain at 5.5%. So in other words, the black income generation has also not been tackled as a result of this. So various things can be said, whether it be with regard to shell companies, income tax returns, etc. They all point to the fact that actually the black income generation process continues. If the black income generation process had come down, then the tax GDP ratio would have risen. Now, the GST, because of GST collections, the tax GDP ratio of indirect taxes has risen, but not of direct taxes, you know. And there also, I would argue that, as Mr. Arun Jaitley said in the parliament, 5% entities in GST pay 95% of the tax, and 95% entities pay 5% of the tax. In other words, it is bulk of the organized sector which is paying the GST. And here, you know, what you found was that initially 1.2 crore entities had registered under GST, but only 70 lakh were filing the return. Now that number has gone up to 1.5 crore and only 1.1 crore are filing their returns. So therefore, what has happened is that the unorganized sector is completely out of this net. So when you see the growth of GST, you're seeing the growth of the organized sector, but not of the unorganized sector. And the hit of demonetization, GST, etc., was in the unorganized sector. And that is the where the data doesn't come. So we assume that the unorganized sector is growing at the same rate as the organized sector, which is incorrect after demonetization when the unorganized sector started declining. So my argument was that actually the economy went into recession during the period of demonetization. Okay. And then GST hit it, and then the NBFC crisis hit it, and now this pandemic has hit it. So it's the unorganized sector, which is not measured separately, that is the one that's getting hurt very badly. And that started with demonetization, but I would not say the entire effect is of demonetization. It's also of GST, it's also of the NBFC crisis, and it's also of the pandemic. But the demonetization started this process of massive inequality growing. And as inequality grows, demand becomes short. And when demand becomes short, the rate of growth of the economy starts falling.
Right.
Because when demand is short, capacity utilization falls. And when capacity utilization falls, investment falls. And you know that in 2012-13, investments had peaked at 36.5%. They fell below 30% before the pandemic, and they fell further during the pandemic. And now the capacity utilization has still not come back to the earlier level. That means the investment has not revived, the private sector investment. Consumption is also down, as the RBI latest data shows that the consumer confidence is down to 55.5.
Right.
Whereas in January 2020, it was 105. So from 105, it has fallen to 55.5. That means consumption is not revived, you know. So all these factors...
Yeah, and like you rightly said, all of this cannot be blamed on the demo, but a lot of it started from there and subsequently kept getting worse for various factors. Yes, Karuna Gopal, over to you.
Yeah. Tanvi, you know, we've seen the discussion. I've seen perspectives like the ant perspective, typically staying on the ground, just looking at demonetization, which will certainly not give us any kind of answers. I have seen some of the panelists who've taken the eagle's eye view. They have looked at the macro perspective. They have understood the interlinkages between demonetization and the GDP growth and several other factors that many conveniently forgot. So it's very important to take the eagle perspective, understand the reciprocal relationships between these multiple elements that work in a huge complex economy like India. And I'd like to also bring to your notice the comment made by the Congress spokesperson, which I think is absolutely appalling and quite ridiculous at best, which is he wants to combine demonetization with Make in India and all those efforts, which is quite funny, that were coming from Congress. During Congress, as you know, in the last 60 years, we have missed the most critical part of the Industrial Revolution, that is the third Industrial Revolution. We lost to the world. Every Southeast Asian economy flourished because of their manufacturing. We are trying to right the wrong, Mr. Anshul. You must understand that. And you have absolutely no idea how startups have been nurtured in this country. We were not even on the startup map for many, many years. Now today we are actually producing unicorns. Now let's take a macro perspective. Mm-hmm. I like the equanimity of some of the panelists like Professor Agarwal and Madhavan Narayan, and of course Dua. That's important to really see, get how the country is moving. Not take a ant perspective, go drill down into everything, you know, give statistics to confuse and confound, you know, people.
Actually, I would say it should be exactly the other way around. To understand and to judge the impact of any big government policy decision, we must go into the details, we must go into the depths, look at all available data, and then take a decision. And not just back then, but keep a close track of it and track it for years together to see exactly where we reach. That's how I would say an exhaustive analysis can be done and a judgment can be given. I am completely out of time. Last 30 seconds to Anshul, since he patiently heard everybody out. Yeah.
No. My one quick rebuttal was that, you know, I mentioned Make in India because it didn't create jobs and output. And even now, there are no jobs and output being created. That is a fundamental question. You know, the question of inflation was, earlier on, we had inflation in the UPA years, but inflation had an inverse relationship with unemployment. It created jobs and output. Now there is cost-put inflation. There are no jobs at all. And that can be reflective on our figures. And DEMO did that. DEMO took away demand, as Professor Kumar mentioned. Since there is no demand, there is no money in the hands of the people. There is no fiscal sort of stimulus in the hands of the people. How can you create jobs? How will the economy actually go, you know, turn? The wheels of the economy turn. So this is my point. I mean, unless you have demand, you cannot have the economy running at the moment. And all the figures that are coming in are high frequency figures. This is all high frequency data. It is not a true reflection of the health of our overall economy.
Okay, completely out of time. On that note, I'm going to thank all of you for joining me on this conversation. Suffice to say, viewers, that while, yes, there were certain benefits that came out of this, also got a boost from other external factors, such as more people being pushed into the digital economy, more people into the formal economy. But there is also a large cost that came along with demonetization. And just like we discussed this 5 years ago, now we can do the same with statistics, with hard evidence that suggests that the cost with which it came was not worth the benefit. That there could have been several other ways that the government could have moved the country into a more transparent setup, a more transparent economy, a more formalized economy where everything gets recorded, everything gets punched into the system and you're able to track it. If that was actually the agenda, there are so many more methods that experts across the country will tell you could have been used, perhaps would have taken a couple of years more than what we are looking at right now. But at the cost of people who lost their businesses, at the cost of companies that could never bounce back, at the cost of those businesses that slowed down and then subsequently further got hit by several other changes that came into the economy, I don't think so. Black money still exists, thrives. Cash still exists, very much so, in large, maybe in a higher quantity than it did before demonetization. So yes, while many of us do use digital transactions, cash is still king in this country. Black money and corruption still exists. Thank you for joining us.